So this is going to be a demonstration of the thoracic wall, anterior thoracic wall, which we have removed from this cadaver here. So first, let's quickly identify the parts of the skeleton here. This is the manubrium sterni. This is the body of the sternum. This is the xiphoid process. So therefore, this is the manubrium sternal joint, or the sternal angle of Louis. This is the xiphosternal joint. These are the ribs. This is the first rib on either side, second, third, fourth, and so on and so forth. And the last rib is the seventh rib. So therefore, the ribs form what is known as the sternocostal joint. The lateral portion of the rib is bony, the medial portion of the rib is cartilaginous. So therefore, this is a costochondral articulation. After the seventh rib, the eighth, ninth, and the tenth ribs, they articulate directly with the seventh ribs in what is known as the interchondral or the chondrochondral articulation. Let's take a quick look at the manubrium sterni. This is the jugular notch of the manubrium sternum. This is in the root of the neck. These two are the articulation for the medial end of the clavicle. This is articulation with the first rib. And we can see the first rib has got several other structures attached to it, namely the subclavius muscle and the scalenus anterior muscle. Incidentally, this side first rib has got an exostosis, and we can feel exostosis on the inner surface also. The first rib forms a synchondrosis with the manubrium sterni. There is no movement at this joint with the first rib. This is the second rib, and we have mentioned that the second rib articulates with the sternal angle of Louis. How do we count the intercostal spaces? The intercostal spaces are below the corresponding rib. So therefore, if this is the first rib, this is the first space. Second rib, this is the second space, and so on and so forth. This is the costal margin, and this is the xiphoid process. This angle that we see here, this is referred to as the subcostal angle. This is referred to as the manubrium sternal angle or the sternal angle of Louis. So these are some important landmarks that we can see. From the first to the seventh ribs, these are known as true ribs. Eighth, ninth, and tenth ribs, which articulate with the seventh rib, they are known as false ribs because they don't articulate with the sternum. And the 11th and 12th ribs, which you cannot see, are called floating ribs because they articulate only with the vertebral column. They don't have any anterior articulation. So this is the classification of the ribs. Now let's focus on the muscles that we see here. These are the intercostal muscles. The intercostal muscles are in three layers. The outermost is the external intercostal muscle. And if you take a close look, you'll see that the direction of fibers are as if the hands are in the pocket. That means they're going downwards obliquely and inferiorly. Then we have the next layer of muscle, and for that I'm going to remove a few fibers of the external and show the next layer of fibers, and we can see some of the fibers of the next layer. This is the internal of the internal direction of fibers are exactly opposite to the external, as if the hands are crossed over to the opposite chest. The internal has got two parts. One portion which is in relation to the bony portion of the ribs, that is known as the interosseous part. And there is another portion which is in relation to the cartilaginous part of the ribs, which is where my instrument has gone in, that is known as the interchondral part. So that brings me to the action of the external intercostal and the internal intercostal. The external intercostal is responsible for elevation of the ribs during forced respiration. The internal intercostal, the interosseous part, is responsible for depression of the ribs during forced respiration, while the interchondral part is responsible for, again, elevation of the ribs during forced respiration. The principle behind this is that when the directional fibers are at right angles to the direction of the long axis of the rib, then it produces depression. And when the directional fibers are almost parallel to the direction of the long axis of the rib, like in the interchondral part, then they are responsible for elevation of the ribs. The external intercostal, if you continue further medially, as we can see them here, medially the external intercostal disappears and it is replaced by this membrane here. We can see the membrane of this space, we can see the membrane in this space. I have lifted it up with my instrument, and we can see the membrane in this space also. So the medial portion of the external intercostal is replaced by the external intercostal membrane closer to the sternum. The internal intercostal also does the same thing on the posterior aspect, which we cannot see here. As it goes posteriorly towards the vertebral column, it disappears and it is replaced by the internal intercostal membrane. And deep to the internal intercostal, we have a very thin muscle layer, which is known as the innermost intercostal, subcostal, and transversus thoraces. I shall show part of it when I turn the chest wall. Let me tell you quickly now movement of the ribs in respiration. The upper ribs up to the 7th ribs. They are responsible for what is known as pump handle movement of the chest wall, where by virtue of their movement, they increase the anterior posterior diameter of the chest. The lower ribs, the 8th, 9th and 10th ribs, they are responsible for what is known as bucket handle movement of the chest, whereby they increase the transverse diameter of the chest wall. And of course, not visible here is the diaphragm, which when it moves down and up, it changes the vertical diameter of the chest wall. Before I turn this chest wall here, I would like to show you this neurovascular structure here, which I have lifted up. This is one neurovascular structure. We can see it is running in relation to the lower border of the rib above. And this is another neurovascular structure, which is also running in relation to the lower border of the rib above. Whenever we need to do any intrathoracic procedure, like for example, pleurocentesis, we should insert the needle closer to the upper border of the rib below and further away from the lower border of the rib above. The reason being, the neurovascular structures are running close to the lower border of the rib above. So therefore, in pleurocentesis, we usually use the 5th intercostal space in the mid-axillary line for doing pleural tap in cases of pleural effusion. Likewise, if we want to anesthetize an intercostal space, we must remember that the main neurovascular bundle, the vein artery nerve, runs in relation to the lower border of the rib above, and the collateral branch runs in relation to the upper border of the rib below. Therefore, we have to anesthetize two sets of neurovascular bundles to completely anesthetize one intercostal space. So these are some of the surgical procedures and clinical applications of the chest wall. Thank you very much for watching. Dr. Sanjoy Sanyal signing out. If you have any questions or comments, please put them in the comment section below. Have a nice day.